Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming to our Advocan series on today. We're talking about person-centered planning. And we are really going to just do an overview of person-centered planning. What is it? And kind of what is Loveland's way that we go about doing it? Why is it important? What are some of the aspects you should be looking at? And then some of the things that we do here at Loveland to really implement person-centered planning. I'm going to. So our discussion points today, first thing I'm going to talk about is the Loveland mission. We're going to then define person-centered planning. We're going to talk about some of the technical aspects of person-centered planning, the assessments, plans, what is your responsibilities as a family and caregiver? What's the Loveland philosophy, our dare to dream, and dignity of risk with safeguarding? I want to point out that some things that I may say, not every parent always agrees with, because I have a way of looking at things a little bit different, but it's okay. And we're allowed to look at things differently. But I just want to let you know that you may say, oh, I would want to see a little bit more, not as much risk involved. But we believe that our individuals are adults that we are working with and that we want to help them become as independent as possible. The Loveland mission is to support individuals with intellectual and developmental disabilities to live their lives to the fullest. You notice I have it there, highlighted in red because it's not my life. I don't want them to live my life to the fullest. I don't want them to live the life that I would want them to live because they're their own person. Living a life to the fullest is different for every single person. And it's important, other things are important to different people. I may enjoy going and spending time with my family where somebody else may not. So we want to make sure that when we're doing what we're doing, we're looking at that person saying, what can we do for you? The people here that we're supporting at Loveland Center are the heart of everything we do. And again, I mentioned it that you as a parent may hear something tonight that maybe you like don't agree with, but it's okay. It's a great discussion point and we can talk about it. So what is person-centered planning? Person-centered planning is a process where the person that is being talked about is the center of everything there. They're part of that process. It is their life and they're having input on their life. It reminds me a little bit if you were to think about when the US started, and there was the British government coming and controlling everything here in the United States, and there was taxes and things put on. It was no taxation without representation. I look at this the same way, is don't do something for me without me. I will tell you that while I have been in the field going now on 32 years professionally, I do not always do the best job at this. And it is okay that we sometimes forget what our role is. Let me tell you a little story. There was a young lady that I was asked to help out not long ago, living in the village. And we sat there, her support team, it was the management team of the village. And it was her mom and her support coordinator and the person who provided the supports in the house and the manager of the person that provided the supports in the house and this young lady. And we sat down and had this great conversation. And when I say we, I would say all of the support team had a fantastic conversation. We talked about how we could go about supporting her and making sure her life was fantastic living in the village. And she had been living there for a little while. And we came up with this fantastic plan. And we spoke for about an hour. And after about an hour, she looked up and said, I don't want to live here. I don't want to go back. And I said, oh, wow, did we really screw up here? We didn't look at the most important person and get their opinion and their perspective on what should be happening. And that is, we should have talked to her first. We had this great plan as a great team, thinking the best for her without actually looking at her and saying, what is it that you want? So I want to talk about that is the heart behind it. What is person-centered planning? It's ensuring that the plan that we're coming up with is centered around that person and it is their input on it. We use it, it says right in here, providers use a person-centered planning approach to listen and discover and understand each person as an individual and help us develop a plan for helping them move their life forward. So why does it matter? The planning process empowers the person to build on their specific abilities to build a quality life for themselves. Other factors, there are things that are here that are in here, such as we got to look at their health and wellness. We got to look at what is the foundation of their life? What are things in the that they have and what are their goals in their life? So we note that while we might have a person-centered plan, maybe not the person cannot do every single thing they want to do. There does have to be safeguards put in place. And I want you to know that up ahead of our discussion is that safeguards are necessary for a person to ensure that they can have a quality life, while at the same time looking at what are their wants and their needs and how do we go ahead and help fulfill those. So that some of the technical aspects of planning, things that you will hear about when we talk about person-centered planning is there are lots of assessments, types of assessments. Here in Florida, we have a questionnaire for situational information or a QSI. This is really completed by APD on an annual basis before the person support plan. And really what they're doing is looking at what is the functional needs of the person, what is the behavioral needs, what are some of the communication things that they're going to want to be doing, what are their goals? And they actually set a score for each person and then provide funding based off of that QSI. While the QSI is great for setting funding, I don't believe the QSI is the best plan that you have or really developing a personalized support plan for a person. Some of the things that we use here at Loveland Center above a QSI is we have a functional assessment that really talks about the day-to-day needs of the person for their activities of daily living. Can they eat independently? Do they need any support with ambulation? Do they need any support in recreation? Can they use the restrooms independently? So we do those on a every other year basis. When a first person comes in, we ask them to do a functional assessment, and then our staff that's done by the families, and then our staff will do a functional assessment on each person that we work with every 2 years later, so every other year. Behavioral assessment. Again, it's a support. It's a development of a level of support of maintaining control of oneself. What type of behavioral support do I need? We work with some people that may have some impulse control or some wandering, and what type of level of support are we going to need for those? Community mobility assessment is an assessment tool that we utilize as we go out in the community. Is can this person be independent on their own? It is a tool that we utilize here. We ask you as families to do this prior to coming in to say, what do you feel that person needs? And then we can build the safeguards utilizing that tool. And then the last assessment that we utilize here is a recreational interest assessment. And that's because we want to know what's fun for the person. We want to know what type of things do they do that they enjoy, because we want to make sure that what we're doing is enjoyable for the person that we're serving. So your role as a caregiver is, I would say, to be honest. And some people look at me and say, well, that's a weird thing for you to say, Patrick. I will tell you that I ask you to be honest, because what we tend to see when we have a new person coming in to our program is either the family member, when they're filling something out, will say, well, I don't want to tell them all of these other things that are actually happening because they may not want to accept my child or my sister or my brother. If I tell them that, they tend to run off. Or we have it the other direction where sometimes a lot of families come back to us and say, I need to make sure I tell them every single thing. And my son or daughter or sister or brother, they're actually a horrible, horrible person. I'm going to tell them all these terrible things. Or maybe not even terrible. I'm going to tell them things that they can't do. And I sometimes find it's in the middle. So what we really need is for you to be accurate as a family member when you're doing your questionnaires and you're filling out your assessments. It doesn't help us to get an assessment where we don't have all of the information for your family member, and you tell us that maybe they wander off, and then I don't have the staffing level put in place for your son or daughter, sister, brother, family member to make them successful while we're here. Or I don't have the staff be aware that they will wander off. So we need to make sure that we keep them within eyesight of us at all times while we're working with other people. So it's important that you as a caregiver be accurate. The other thing is you need to be open to multiple perspectives from different providers. One of the great things about assessments is that a lot of people get to see people in different areas of their life and in different locations. Let me tell you, I worked with a young man where he was moving into one of my residential homes. And when I went and sat with his mom said to me, he can't do anything. Now, I will tell you, when I say young man, he was in his mid-60s. His mom was in her 80s. Maybe even 90s, and she said he can't do anything. He can't cook. He doesn't answer the phone. He can't clean. We have to do everything for him. How we do our plans is we do a quick little plan, and then we get to know a person for 30 days and rewrite a plan. In the 30 days after he moved into one of our houses, I came to visit him, and I knocked on the door, and the first person at the door was this person. Actually, his name was Pat. So I can just, his name was Pat. Pat answered the door. He said, "Hey, how are you?" Invited me in. I came in and I was looking and they were cooking that night. I'm like, "Oh, what are you guys making?" And Pat's like, "We are making hot dogs." He was cooking that day. The phone rang. He ran over, picked up the phone. All things his mom said he couldn't do, but he actually did. It happened to mom, just took care of him very well. And she didn't see his ability. She didn't see his ability to do all these things. So when we sat down for our big planning team meeting, she was very upset that we were not telling the truth about him. So you need to be open to multiple perspectives of different providers because they will see your son and daughter, sister, brother, in a different area, and they may act differently. The third thing I would ask for you to do is encourage the person being assessed to take part in the assessment. If they're capable and they're able to sit and answer the questions, have them do that because it's, again, it's about them and it's what do they feel they're able to do. And a lot of times as a parent, I know I do the same thing. I may look at my son and think, well, he can't do that. And where he goes, no, I can do it. I could just take a little longer. So we need to encourage them to be part of taking that assessment. The next one is really a personal span is the personal support plan process. This is the process that is utilized to actually develop the personal support plan. Years ago, about 24 years ago, I was what we call here in Florida a waiver support coordinator. And I did that for a number of years. And I utilized this personal plan process to really help me develop my ISP, or here it's called an IPP. What's beautiful about a personal support plan is it's really about the individual taking control of that process. The individual can have whoever they want to have in that meeting. If they have a guardian, or if they're independent, they don't have a guardian, they don't have to have a person there. You see at the bottom, it says that the individual representative should have a participatory role as needed and defined by the individual, unless the state law and state confers decision-making authority to a legal representative. So if you're not their guardian, I want you to be aware that the person can say, I don't want my family member to be part of this planning process. It is legal for them to do it as long as they have that level of ability to make those decisions. There was a gentleman that I worked with back in New York who was very well of his rights and knew that his mom was not his legal guardian. He had some behavioral concerns, and part of our process was that we, followed up to let family know that these are the issues that we were having. And he was able to take it upon himself every time there was behavioral concern is say, I don't want you to tell my mom. And we could not do that because it was his right to not have us share information about him because she did not have the legal authority to actually know everything about him. That's a negative thing. Let's move more positive. So part of the planning process is the person gets to choose who they want to have. The person really needs to know and have intimate knowledge of the individual. They need to be able to help identify their known risk. They need to assist the individual to plan for the future and provide support if requested. They really should be there reviewing and approving the plan and signing documents of the support plan. They should have an opportunity to share any concerns or disagreements with the planning process. I don't like how this is happening. You skipped over being able to talk about the person's safeguards, and you went right to the what's the most important thing in your life, and we're not going to talk about how maybe some negative things about that thing that they're asking about. And then sharing their concerns throughout the year with the MSC or the WSC, they need to be able to do that as they review some of the documentation. So the plan process itself, one of the most fun things for me to do when I was a support coordinator was to actually have these meetings. And I got to, my first thing was to call that person and sit down and say, hey, it's time for your support plan. Let's sit down. Who do you want to have come? And then they would tell me, who do you want to come? Where do you want to have it? You want to have it at your day program today, this year? Okay, we'll have it at the day program. When are you available? And we would try to set it up with them. And actually, I would try to get the person to be able to invite people out to their meeting. They might invite their favorite staff. They might invite their parent. They're going to invite, they might invite a family member who is not their parent to come. And we would all come together and sit down. The individual then directs the process. The best thing about really person-centered planning is having the opportunity for that person to take control of their life and say, all right, this is my plan. Let's talk about what's going on at my house. Let's talk about what's going on at my program. Let's talk about my work environment. If that person's not able to do that, then a lot of times it will fall to the support coordinator or to a family member to help facilitate that meeting. I look at it was really a conversation with the person instead of talking about just things that need to be done for that person. It was, let's talk about some things that are good for you. I always looked at the planning time as a time to reflect on the year, but also to be very positive about the person and the great things that have happened during the year. We don't want this to be a negative time. We want to talk about, hey, we see that you have improved in X, Y, and Z, and we are working towards the goal that you have. And we're excited because this is where you are at it. Instead of being negative during that time place. When I set these things up, I would actually set whiteboards up. Those who know me know I love my whiteboards. I would set whiteboards up and I would say, okay, let's talk about your home environment and talk about the things that you want to work on at home. And let's talk about your work environment and let's talk about your friends and let's talk about your dreams and your goals. And we would write all of those things down to start developing our plan. And we would come up with goals written for the support plan based on what's important to that individuals and not based on what can the service providers do for that person. Let me go to the next screen. All right, I'm going to do this as a warning. All right. The next thing that we're really going to talk about, a lot of times I would say that as family members is the hardest thing that we have to do and to talk about. And the thing that we're going to talk about is the dignity of risk. And this comes with any time that we really focus on person-centered planning and really focus on that person. Us as, I can speak of myself as a parent, when it comes to doing something for my child, I am always concerned about risk. So what is the dignity of risk? Dignity of risk is the idea that Self-determination and the right to make reasonable risks are essential for dignity and self-esteem, and so should not be impeded or excessively cautious caregivers. She concerned about their duty of care. So the concept here is applicable really to adults that are elderly people, people with mental health, people with disabilities, also children with disabilities. You will often hear times of people saying, no, you can't do that. That's too risky for you to do. So we're not going to even allow you to do that. Honestly, here at Loveland, I like to challenge that notion. I always like to challenge it because I believe that there is a way that we can go about doing things, giving people dignity of risk to grow. Because if you never try anything, you're never going to do anything. Here's a video that is actually been going around right now. I saw it 2 days ago and I thought this is fantastic. So I just want to play it real quick.
Hey, bartender, you assume that I cannot drink a margarita, so you don't serve me a margarita? If I don't drink a margarita, your assumption becomes reality. And parents, you assume that I cannot live on my own, so you don't encourage me to live on my own, so I don't live on my own. Coach, you assume that I cannot hit harder, so you don't train me to hit harder, so I don't hit harder. And teacher, you assume that I cannot learn Shakespeare, so you don't teach me Shakespeare.
Old McDonald, a farm.
So I don't learn Shakespeare. E-I-E-I-O. But hey, if all your assumptions become reality, then assume that I can drink a margarita. Will you serve me a margarita? So I drink a margarita. Assume that I can live on my own. So I live on my own. Assume that I can hit harder. So I hit harder. Assume that I can learn Shakespeare. So, what fools these mortals be? I learned fucking Shakespeare. You assume I can't swear, right? You assume that I can do that job. That I can go to parties. That I can have sex. That I can be on stage. Assume that I can. So maybe I will. Hey, bartender.
Oops. Sorry, guys. Trying to figure out how to get to the next screen. There we go. Dignity of Risk. This is a poem that was written back in the 80s, actually, by an individual who was living in a group home in, I believe, West Virginia. For those members who have been board members, would be they would know this because I've read it to them before. The Dignity of Risk. What if you never got to make a mistake? What if your money was always kept in an envelope where you couldn't get it? What if you were never given a chance to do well at something? What if you were always treated like a child? What if your only chance to be with people different from you was with you, your own family? What if the job you did was not useful? What if you never got to make a decision? What if the only risky thing you could do was act out? What if you couldn't go outside because the last time you went out, it rained? What if you took the wrong bus once and now you can't take another one? What if you got into trouble and you were sent away and you couldn't come back because they were always remembered that you were trouble? What if you worked and got paid 46 cents an hour? What if you had to wear a winter coat when it rained because it was all you had? What if you had no privacy? What if you could do part of the grocery shopping but weren't allowed to do any of it because you weren't able to do all of it? What if you spent 3 hours every day just waiting? What if you grew old and never knew adulthood? What if you never got a chance? I think it's a pretty powerful thing. I want to talk about a person that I've known for the past 25 years. His name is Fred. He's a person that I was his support coordinator back in 2001. And Fred taught me a lot about the idea of the dignity of risk. Fred was a gentleman who had cerebral palsy. When I started working with him, he was in his late 40s, early 50s. And he was living in a group home with six other people. And I happened to be a support coordinator at the time. And one day Fred came up to me and he said, "Patrick, I really want to live in my own place. You know, I don't really like living in this group home. I think I could do more. But my parents want me to be here because they think it's safer." Now I should also mention that Fred was in a wheelchair. And Fred needed a lot of support and assistance. So I said, okay, let's see what we can do, Fred. And I was able to find Fred an apartment in the Derby area. So we moved him about 30 miles from where he was at. We found an apartment and he moved in there and he had two roommates. And Fred was happy. About a year later, Fred came to me and said, hey, Patrick, I appreciate you helping me find this apartment, but you know, I still have two roommates. I really want to live in my own place. And I said, okay, let's see what we can do. So I was able to, took me a little bit of time and I was able to find Fred a different apartment, and he happened to have one roommate, and it was a person about his age, a woman about his age. That didn't last as long as I would have hoped. And Fred came back to me and he said, Patrick, hey, we talk about this. I really want to have my own apartment. And at the time that we were having a conversation, the organization that I was working for was developing an apartment complex. So I was able to get Fred his own apartment in there. And it was each one of these were apartments, but they were still group homes. In the state of Florida, group home could be one person. So I was able to find him a group home, group living situation where it was an apartment complex and there was 8 apartments in the building and 12 people living there. But it was everyone was there and they were able to do things. And he had a single apartment. In this time, I actually left my job as a support coordinator to do some other things. 3 years after I left that job, I was working on something for the Office for People with Disabilities, talking about person-centered planning and are we doing a good job identifying and actually doing what the individuals want us to do. And it was great because Fred popped up on my list to talk to and ask how are things going. So I was like, you know, this is going to be a slam dunk. We got Fred his own place. And I came in and I sat down and I talked with Fred and we spent a couple hours together. And one of the things that he said to me is, Patrick, I really would like to move into my own place. And I was like, Fred, I don't get it. We moved you to an apartment with two people, and then you have your apartment with two people. Now, for the last 3 to 4 years, you've been living in your own place in the apartment. He said, no, Patrick, I live in your place. I live in a place that is what you guys chose for me, what my parents chose for me, what just the staff chose for me, what the support chose me. He said, at this time, Fred was nearly 60 years old. So maybe it was more, not late 50s. Or late 40s. He was closer to 60 years old because I remember saying, I'm almost 60 years old and I've never once lived in my own place. So from there, we took the opportunity to really develop a plan for Fred and find him a place where I will tell you where we found him to live. It would not be the place that I would want to live, but it is the place that he wanted to live. It was his own place. He had staff support that was coming in once a day, just to check up on him to make sure things are good. But it was fantastic for us to have that opportunity to say, okay, I hear you now, Fred. Let's find a place for you. But what we had to do when we were doing this was really develop and mitigate any sort of risk that we had. Fred had a big concern when we did talk about it, and his parents had a big concern is, well, you know, Fred's not young any longer. What's going to happen if Fred got hurt? So we utilize these principles of risk. You know, we had this personal centered conversation and we talked about the plans. We talked about the different things to mitigate any risk. What was the important thing for Fred was for him to move in on his own. And what could we do to help limit the risk? Fred's big thing was, if I get hurt or I get sick and I go to the hospital, what's going to happen? And I actually had to say to him, Fred, what happens if your mom gets hurt or goes to the hospital? He said, well, she'll go to the hospital. And I said, okay, your dad's not able to take care of her at home. What would happen afterward? And he said, well, she would probably go to a rehab. And I said, you would do the same thing.
Oh.
So his big fear was he would be left alone, but he would go to a rehab. So a lot of times when we're talking about giving people the opportunity to take care or do something that is quote unquote risky from our perspective, because the person may have an IDD, I apologize, I don't know why my phone is ringing. it is something that we can look at, and it gets blown out of proportion, but it's actually something I think that from a team we can look at and say, okay, how do we minimize this risk? Second thing, being wary of overgeneralizations or exaggerated risks, right? Because you're vulnerable in one part of your life does not mean that you're going to need the same protections in all parts of your life. We do have a tendency to overgeneralize from one area of a person's life to another. There's a gentleman who lives in our, who goes to our Port Charlotte location, extremely independent gentleman for most of his life. I was sitting there talking to him one day and he said, you know, Patrick, my parents don't let me shop. And I'm like, what do you mean they don't let you shop? I go, you worked at Publix for like 15 years. And he said, they don't let me shop because sometimes I screw up with the money. So I'm not allowed to do any sort of shopping. So because he had a deficit in money management, meant for his parents that they wouldn't allow him to do any part of shopping. Instead of trying to develop a support in place for him to do most of the shopping and maybe supporting him with the money management part of it, he was just not allowed to do anything. And we were able to really work with his family on that. And he put that into one of his plans and his goals of, I want to learn how to shop and I want to show my parents that I know how to shop. So he worked with us, or we worked with him on ensuring that he was able to move forward. The beautiful part about that, and this is an aside, is that right now what we live is really in a cashless society. So we were able to help him identify, hey, I can take a bank card and I can go there and I don't have to worry about giving a person cash and taking the money back, because that's where I was getting in trouble. I just know that I'm paying attention to when the things are going through the shopping and I utilize my card and make sure I have enough money on there before I go in order to shop. So we don't actually necessarily have to know the big coin is 25 cents, the small coin is a dime. And what a difference of the dollars were if we have our credit card with us or our debit card with us. Risk for a person can change. A person changes over time. We all improve and we decline. So another principle of risk that we have to be paying attention to when we're talking about these things and we're doing person-centered planning is, hey, I'm not the same person I was 2 years ago. You heard me at the beginning talking about our assessments that we do here at Loveland. Every 2 years, we do a functional assessment because we know a person's abilities are going to increase and decrease over time. We're hoping to see that people that were working with are improving in their skills. And that's one of the things that we do here is life skills development. So what we are working on, we're seeing them improve. So then we can move on to an area that they can work a little bit more on. But sometimes they decline. And we need to be able to assess that and ensure that we're putting the proper supports in place for them when they do decline. People should also make informed choices about what risks they're willing to take. You know, so identifying the risk for a person is just as much about being happy as it is about their safety. And we talked earlier, their safeguards is an important thing. While we want the person to have real input and control in their lives, I wouldn't want a person to come and say, you know, it's really my desire to go out and shoot drugs. That's not something that we would want them to do. So we would want to make sure that they're aware of the decisions they're making. And just like you and I, we need to talk through them and put those safeguards in place and say, okay, this is not a good decision. And these are the consequences that can happen in your life if you make those choices. A lot of times we don't necessarily have control over that. And some people will make their own choices, even though we're talking about the consequences. And it's tough because part of the dignity of risk is there is both sides. The dignity of risk is that I can succeed, but I can also fail. And that's the consequence of what might happen. Again, I worked with a young man who was back in New York and he lived in one of our apartments and he was, for lack of a better term, he needed very little support, but he did need some support in making quality decisions in his life. And he would make decisions and stay out all night and get arrested and then be upset with the fact that he was arrested for doing something while he was out. He was drinking in public or he was, he broke into a place and he would get upset with being arrested saying, well, I'm disabled. I shouldn't be arrested. But those were the consequences of his actions that we really needed to work with him on, of understanding that not every choice is the right choice. Certain things might be non-negotiable, right? When we talked about, I talked about just a little bit ago, the idea that a non-negotiable might be like, hey, you're not going to go out and go hang out at the drug den down the road. I think that as the team gets together, we talk person-centered planning, there we might say, yeah, I understand you, I hear you, but this is a non-negotiable because we really believe that this is detrimental to your life. We don't want you to be exploited. We don't want you to be injured. We don't want you to be harmed. You don't want to violate the law. So these are things that we're going to put in place, and we're going to kind of put some guardrails on you. So it is an all right thing to do, to put guardrails up in place for the people that, pardon me, want to make some of these choices. We also need to discuss barriers, challenges, obstacles for the person. What might be barriers, challenges, obstacles? If you have a person who it comes to you and says, I want to get a job working construction. That's really what I want to do. But they're in a wheelchair. Maybe what we need to talk about is, okay, they utilize a wheelchair. They can't get around a construction site. There's a barrier that might be there for them. So really talking about what are those things that we can do to help support them with getting a job in the field of construction. Maybe it's not necessarily working at a construction site, but maybe working in the offices at a construction company to help them reach those goals without actually saying, no, you can't do that because you utilize a wheelchair. So part of our planning process will be having those discussions. We need to embrace, embrace a culture of exploration and learning. Everyone who's supporting a person has got to accept some level of responsibility for potential risks. So I talked about Fred, right? Fred's family had to, they had to really embrace the opportunity that Fred is going to be independent in his own home and not have a staff with him at 24 hours a day. I know some people who, their children live with them until they're older. And then all of a sudden the child wants to say, I want to move out. And you have to be able to say, okay, we're going to let them do that. And let's put these supports in place for them and keep checking on them. But we're going to trust that there is a potential for risk, and we can't wrap you up in a bubble at all times. We need to be intolerant of mistakes and have a culture of assigning staff liability. Being intolerant of mistakes and having a culture of assigning staff liability prevents organizations from embracing opportunities for innovative practices, growth, and learning. So what that means is, hey, things do happen, right? If we are going to say every time something bad happens to a person, it's the staff's fault, that staff is, one, you're going to chase the staff away, but two, what is going to end up happening is the staff is never going to help that your family member grow and try to take on new things. If I was to be working with a person who is the community mobility is there, they're never independent, and they really want to go and say, I want to walk around my apartment complex without having a staff walk with me at all times. And the staff is putting a plan in place to say, we're going to teach this person a little bit of community independence and mobility, and I'm going to walk behind them 10 feet for the next month behind them and let them walk through it. And then I'm going to walk behind them 50 feet for the next month and see how they do. And then I'm going to walk behind them 100 feet. And then the next month becomes, I'm going to sit at this place so I can just see them and walk around. But at some point, this person, while the staff is walking behind them 100 feet or so, they trip and fall off of a curb and they hurt their knee. We can't hold that staff responsible because they weren't right there next to them. But this is the plan that we're putting in place to help them, because that's our job, is to help that person grow to be independent. It says it's important to encourage honest exploration of the person's strengths and vulnerabilities. Maybe for that walking opportunity, it might be, okay, we need to go back a couple steps and talk about, hey, there's a curb here. We need to pay attention to this. Or it could be that the person needs glasses, kind of like I have on now, and looking at different things. And then maybe their vulnerability was they could not see. So looking at those and saying, how can we put supports in place to help that person become independent? And safeguards. Safeguards are an important part of the person-centered plan. They're a way to prevent, manage, and lessen risk for every single person. Developing this safeguard should really be in every person's training areas for independence. Here at Loveland, what we do is actually utilize the safeguards that are in the person's ISP or IPP in the state of Florida. But we also will sit down and during their functional assessment, we'll identify what are some of the needs that the person has, and we will write them in there. And then our staff get trained on this is a safeguard this person has. We have a number of people who we do have in with line of vision. Maybe we have somebody who has mobility issues. So we're saying the staff need to walk arm in arm in them. Could be a person who maybe have some eating disability, eating needs where their food needs to be chopped or ground or other things because they have a choking concern. Safeguards could come in the kitchen. We want to make sure that we are reviewing with people. Stoves are hot. You know, we don't touch pans when they're on the stove. We utilize hot pads. We utilize spoons. All of those things in the teaching time for them, because it's important. Medication, when you have glasses, you want to make sure you're cleaning your glasses. All of those things have to be identified in the safeguard, and your staff need to be trained on how to implement those safeguards. So if you're in a program and you don't have those in place, you need to start asking for those things to be added. For those people who are Loveland family members, it is in every single one of our plans. So the Loveland philosophy, if you were on early, you saw I had this sitting on our page, on my shared screen. The Loveland philosophy is the dare to dream. And our dare to dream is done by four different points, and we have points underneath them. Why we call it dare to dream, I want to let you know, is that what I have found over years is that individuals with disabilities, when you ask them what is their dreams, they don't know. I could ask my son what is his dream, and he's going to tell me that my dream is to be go into the service in the Navy and work in the Navy for years. But for some reason, our individuals, I felt, have never really been given that opportunity to say, what is my dream? And when we talk about person-centered planning, that's the key. That's the crux of it. Go off on a little aside. I worked with a gentleman who said, my dream is to work at NASA. And what we tell our staff here is we don't tell our individuals no, that they can't do that. What we tell them is, okay, well, what do you need to do to help get that person to NASA? Because I don't work for NASA. I can't tell that person they couldn't do it. And so we came up with a plan for this young man who was doing it. He was a little overweight. And our plan for him, because getting to NASA could be steps that are this far, and we are this much of the step that helping him. And our job was to help him lose weight so he could get to the point where he could go talk to a person about NASA because he needed to be in better shape. So we had a diet plan for him so he could work towards getting to NASA. Ended up, and his dream was to actually just go to NASA, which was fantastic because we did end up being able to get him an opportunity to go to Cape Canaveral and to see everything there. But again, our job was never to say, no, you can't do that. Our job was to say, how can we do and what can we do to help you get there? So what did we do in our dare dream? We listen. We listen by getting to know every individual. Our staff members, and we'll talk a little bit about our process in a little bit. Our staff members get to know each and every one of your loved ones to know what is their needs, their wants, their dreams. Even if the person is nonverbal, even if the person it needs a lot more assistance than other people. They're not as independent. Our staff get to know them. They get to know their nuances. They get to know the ways they communicate. They encourage trust. They encourage openness. So by listening to them, our individuals that we're working with trust us to be able to confide in us in a little bit more. And we listen so we can hear their wants and needs. The next thing we do is we identify dreams and we develop a plan to help that person achieve them. I just talked about the young man who wanted to go to NASA. We did something that was helping him get to that. We identify what needs are there for to serve that person and serve every single person. And we identify different possibilities for them. We support them. We support an individual's right to choose and to explore. Very first slide or second slide that we had was the Loveland mission. We help individuals with intellectual and developmental disabilities live their life to the fullest. So our job is really to help provide opportunities for that person to learn more, to make choices, to explore their world, and to say, it's not just necessarily I have to go to a program where I sit there, but what else is there for me to do in my life? We help them become part of and not apart from their community. Here in our Venice campus, we used to actually have this sign out front before a person ran it over with their car. And it really said on it, Loveland Center, not a part of, but sorry, be a part of, not apart from the community. So it's our job and our goal to always push out, to always be off campus. When I'm helping a person learn how to shop, the young man that I talked about in our Port Charlotte location, we didn't go shopping for him. We took him to the shopping that was closest to his house so he could learn to be part of his community. We wanted to be there. That does a number of things. One, it helps our individuals get to know their community. But two, it helps the community get to know our individuals. It helps the community say, oh, I know that person. They're John. My goal is always to say people just know them as John and not John from Loveland. But I think that takes time to get there. And so by being out in our community, be part of our community gets to know our individuals get to know our community. There's a little bit of safeguards there because as we're teaching things out in the community, we're talking about safeguards. We're talking about personal safety, stranger danger, walking properly, things like that. And the community is getting to know them and kind of keeping an eye out for each person. And we support an experiential learning model here. We talked about money management. Money management, sitting down there going over money every single day and saying, this is a dollar, this is $10, this is a quarter, doesn't really help if you never get to spend that money. So we believe that we should be learning something here on our campus, but then also getting out in the community and experiencing it in person. And we respect individuality by encouraging choice. Our individuals choose the programs that they want to be part of. Our individuals help choose what that program does throughout the day. We focus on what can be done, not on what cannot be done. By being positive and saying, yep, we can do this, or how do we help this person do this? It helps them, that person, build self-esteem. And we have self-advocacy by building confidence in each person. By helping them build that self-esteem, we can help them advocate for themselves. So let me talk a little bit about the process. I think this is actually my second last slide. We'll talk a little bit about our process. Now, the process that we use here at Loveland Center when we develop our program support plan is very similar to the process that we utilize, or that you should utilize when you're doing your IPP planning. We get the goals from your IPP, and we sit down and we give assessments out to the families. We get the goals from the IPP, and we develop what we call is a pre-ISP. Our intake coordinator pulls all of those things together, has phone conferences and conversations with everybody, and says, okay, we're going to come up with this plan. And then in the next 30 days, our staff really get to know your family members or you yourself, and we develop what really is more person-centered for you. If I am doing, and I, in my plan, it said, I want to learn how to cook. We have a standard cooking training thing, and that goes onto our plan in the, you know, as the pre-ISP. Well, it might come down where in the first 30 days, you realize that I don't know how to use measuring cups. So my plan gets really honed in on that skill that is necessary for me to do, that I'm going to be taking part in the cooking program. And every time that I'm in the cooking program, I am going to measure out the ingredients for what we're cooking. And so that becomes part of my process. Or it could be that I want to work on my reading skills, and I happen to be in the kitchen. So I might be the person who is reading the recipe. or going and reading the shopping list while we go shopping. Those are the kind of things that we really hone in on so we can get the exact goals for that person. A big part of this, though, it becomes the discussion with the person for that 30 days of, hey, this is your goal. What do you want to work on? If that person does not have the ability to communicate those things because maybe their needs are a bit higher, we're going to probably have more of that discussion with the family. This is what we're seeing. We are seeing that John really is not even kind of letting us know when he has to use the restroom. This is the plan that we are hoping to be putting in place. We're going to put a chart in place that every 2 hours we help John go utilize the restroom. What do you think your thoughts are? And because our goal is to help John become independent, and maybe his independence is using the restroom. So if that's one of his goals, so we help them achieve that goal. What I also say is that all of our plans are reviewed with our participants and approved by our participants if they have the ability to improve them. And we also will change it if it's not right. There is a gentleman here. His name is Chris. I had the opportunity when I first got here. I was working with Chris and I wrote his plan with him. And so as I'm sitting there writing his plan, I sat back and I reviewed the plan with him. And he came to me and he said, Patrick, I don't actually want to do that. And I'm like, what do you mean you don't want to do that? He said, well, in the plan, I believe it was that he had a goal to work on art projects. And he goes, that's something the waiver support coordinator wanted me to do. I don't really want to do that. But it was a goal in there. So we kind of have to follow through with what the waiver support coordinator says. But we were able to say, okay, well, we'll make that an assisted area. And then he said, what I really want to work on is finding an opportunity for me to get a job. And we helped him develop job skills and created a plan that was in that manner. So what we try to do is really focus on what the individual wants. Our goals are also all set up in a manner that is an achievement level goal, right? So the goal might be that I am going to show that I am independent 50% of the time with measuring out the recipe. And from there, once I achieve that goal, I move on to the next step. Because remember I talked about at the beginning, we want our individuals to have success. We want to have the program planning process to be a positive thing. So we come back and say, it was fantastic. Patrick made it 40% of the time for 6 months. While we may not have hit the 50% for 3 months in a row, we did see an improvement. But if I made it, it was fantastic. Patrick made this. And we actually changed the goal halfway through the year and took it to the next step because he's improved. And we're seeing that improvement. So it's something important that our plans are always live plans and that they continuously change. Let's see. So year after year, you're going to process, you possibly see changes in those plans as we go through. So that is really what the Loveland planning process is for our person-centered plans. Does anybody have any questions on any of the processes that we have?